Do you know how often I get the same Kia Sorento ad on Prime? Like, do I look like I can drive? We expect ads to be personalized. You know, something related to your interests. So why shouldn't AI agents be the same way? They should be adaptive, learning your preferences and predicting your next move so that the experience gets smoother as you use them. Otherwise, it's just an API that talks in full sentences. So for this video, I'm gonna show you how I build an AI agent with adaptive memory. It searches a recipe API for cuisine, ingredients, and restrictions that a user asks for, and remembers those user preferences for future reference. Let's build it. So here we are in the Botpress studio. I'm gonna show you this bot, a chatbot that connects to the Spoonacular API, which is a food ontology that lets you perform fuzzy search over recipes based on stuff like ingredients, restrictions, diets, cuisines, etc. So the setup I have here is very simple. There's a single autonomous node, for starters, and it conversationally gathers the user's preferences. So it asks stuff about its dietary needs, preferences, whatnot. It confirms that with the user, and then it heads over to the API flow. This is where it fetches from the Spoonacular API. So it enters this flow with the parameters that are going to be used in the API call. Let's have a look at those. First of all, the query, which is just a plain language description, the type of cuisines, and then diet intolerances, the usual stuff when looking for recipes. It enforces that structure. And then we go over to an execute code card that just runs the API call. It runs the API endpoint. I have obviously added my API key and no peeking. Add the parameters. And then we bind the response to the variable here, recipe results. Recipe results is an array of recipe output type that I also designed very descriptively. It exits this flow with recipe results, which means that the main autonomous node can access it. That is hinted to over here. The autonomous node, that is the conversational node where you explain what you want. It translates that information down into API parameters. It makes that API call, and then it comes back to you with API results expressed in plain language. Okay. Test it out. Let's say I'm in the mood for chicken. Great. Looking for any specific chicken dishes or cuisine? Yeah, make it Greek. I'm also allergic to nuts. Okay, now it always confirms with me first. I made it that way specifically because you have very limited API calls on the Spoonacular API free tier. If you kind of let it go rogue, you can run down your API credits pretty quickly. So let's have a look. No, that's all. It's fetching, as we can see here from the logs. And yeah, Greek chicken recipe you might enjoy, nut free. Okay, this is all good and well. Now I want to extend this flow to be able to gather, store, and use user preferences. So the first thing we're gonna do is create a user scoped variable called preferences. It's an array of strings, and it's just an array of the user's custom preference. Now this is an array that's gonna store plain language descriptions of the user's preferences, something like allergic to nuts or likes Greek food. What we wanna do here is create a flow where the preferences are updated. We're gonna create a workflow and call it update user preferences. Now, how this flow should work is that first of all, there should be a plain language description of the preference. This is a workflow variable. Plain language description. Now, we're going to enter the flow with this variable. That means that the autonomous node in the main flow is going to be responsible for writing that variable. Now, what do we do with this preference? Well, we say users.preferences. We add to that array the preference variable. That's it. I like to log these variables, the values, console log, updating user preferences with show the preference. And now round it just for extra certainty. Dunzo. Now we have this flow and we have all the variables we need, but we don't have a way of accessing this flow yet. We have this autonomous node. Right now I have this bare bones prompt that only talks about the ability to make API calls. So we have to clue it about its ability to update user preferences. So in the main objective, we'll add this little bullet point here. I don't know if that's super descriptive, but it's nice to have it peppered throughout the prompt so that it could understand from a high level what it's aimed to do and the conversational flow can feel a little more natural. Okay, we have a section with capabilities. Now we have this one over here making API calls, and this bullet point one is just begging for a two. So we have a section about updating the user's global preferences. I'm gonna be honest, ChatGPT wrote these instructions because you should trust an LLM to determine the best way to convey information to an LLM. So the first things first is we tell it the user can specify preferences like dietary restrictions, allergens, and we move ourselves to the update user preferences flow. Let's add that card here. Now it has the ability to go to that flow.
we move to the user preferences workflow and we set the preference variable, which is the entry variable of this flow. Now, of course, we're letting AI figure out what the value of that variable is, and it should be pretty effective at doing that because we gave a pretty strong description of what it is, and we're giving a very clear description of how to use it here. So we set the preference variable to a brief plain language description of the user's preference, like is allergic to nuts. Now, guide it through how it should deal with this in the conversation, which is in all conversations, recognize the global preferences, and this is maybe a little redundant, users don't need to restate them each time. It should be aware of the preferences and make reference to them, even if the user didn't reference it in this exact conversation. Now, API calls. Use global preferences in combination with any additional session-specific preferences, which means that when it formats the API call with the parameters, it should do that with reference to both whatever's happening in this exact conversation, but also based on the user preferences that the user already has specified. Now, always clarify if a new preference should be saved globally or applied only for the current requests. What that means, essentially, is there's this clear distinction between saying something like I'm allergic to nuts, that's incredibly unlikely to change. I knew a guy, turned out his mom was lying to him his whole life. That changed for him, doesn't matter. However, if I say something like I want chicken for dinner, I can't imagine I'm gonna want that every night. And if I do, I'm probably not using an AI agent to help me come up with new recipes. We have all this set up. The one question is, we have not given this autonomous node explicit access or ability to see the preferences. Now, in theory, it can read it from this user variable over here. And that probably would work just fine. I happen to like hammering it down in the prompt, and this should be a good setup for showing you how to dynamically inject information into a prompt. So I'm adding this little section for user preferences and specifying that it's dynamic injection. Again, this was ChatGPT's decision. Don't shoot the messenger. Okay, the following preferences are available and should be considered in all API calls. We said that already. And how we're gonna do that is double curly brace to evoke JavaScript. Now we reference the user preferences object. Now we go through the items in it, and we format them to be markdown formatted bullet points. Oops, cool. For the time being, it's stored to an array. I wanna say that if you want to build out a more sophisticated bot, it might help you to use a knowledge base for this, but that kind of goes into data engineering. It's not in the scope of this demonstration I'm giving you. Now, publish the sucker. So here we are now on this little website I built for this chatbot. It's about a fictional drag queen named Dean R. Wattsford, because with this bot, you ask, what's for Dinar? Something that you should know, in case you're unaware, is that when you deploy a Botpress bot using web chat, as long as you use the same bot ID and the same client ID, and you are on the same host, in my case, that's just the local host, then your user will persist across sessions. So now let's see how the user data persistence works. So start it off, hey, yeah, I'm allergic. Now I have the option to save as a global preference. Cool, saved as a global preference. I also love my desserts chocolatey. I never know whether to spell this with an E or without an E. Yeah, another global preference. I like salmon. I also have some quinoa I'd like to use up. Great, salmon quinoa risotto. There you have it. You use salmon and quinoa. It's nut-free, as you'd imagine a risotto to be, but I feel like people put almonds in risotto. Now, the million-dollar question is, will this persist across sessions? Again, I could start a new session, and we're going to have the same user. I'll start a new conversation, and I go, hey, okay, do I have any user preferences saved? Yes. Okay. Allergic to nuts, loves chocolatey desserts. That obviously saved across from the last session. This is great. Now what we're going to do is reset the session and make sure that it's not like saving it on the bot level. This is not really a $1 million question. It's just kind of like a sanity test and also an opportunity to show you how to do that. So here we go into cookies and site data. And we just delete whatever data is being stored. We're gonna have to obviously reload the page to enact that, but when we start it, we are not brought back to the same conversation, a swell indicator that it's working so far. And now I ask the same thing, hey, do I have any preferences saved? Okay, I don't have any preferences saved. This is an indication that everything worked as it should. There you have it. I didn't show things like deleting preferences or modifying them. I think that you understand the flow such that you can start to figure that out yourselves, but of course, let me know if that's something you'd be interested in. So that is how you build an AI agent with adaptive memory. Thank you for watching. If you want more details about user authentication and storing session info, you can check out this Chrome extension I built on top of Botpress. If you want a bot to apply dynamic personalization to, might I suggest this AI email assistant from a previous video. If you have questions, hit us up in the comments. And if you'd like to join our community, I'll leave a link to the Discord down below. Bye.